Hey, we're Muna,
and we're here at WNXP.
Yeah.
Sundown and I'm feeling lifted. Downtown cherry lipstick. Watch a silk dress dancing in the wind. Watch it brush against your skin. Makes me wanna try it on. Life's so fun, got my mini skirt and my rollerblades on. Bag on my set cause I'm up till dawn. Keeping it light like silk chiffon. Life's so fun, don't need to worry about no one. She said that I got her if I want. She's so soft like silk chiffon. Silk chiffon.
Okay, I'm good. I'm good.
You're gonna say that I'm on a high horse. I think that my horse is regular sized. Do you ever think maybe you're on a pony, going in circles on a carousel ride? You're gonna say I asked for the moon. I think that it's you with your head in the sky. All that I wanted was somebody honest, living for more than the next good time. You say that you wanna change, well I hope you get everything you want, everything you want. You say that you need relief, well I hope you get everything you need, everything but me. Cause I don't wanna stick around trying to work it out when everything feels wrong, everything feels wrong. But it's all
That was pretty good to me.
It was okay. It was good enough, right? Yeah.
Hey, it's Celia here with Muna in the Sonic Cathedral at WNXP, which we now have a new medley that she made for us. We'll play on air every time we do our call letters.
That's amazing.
WNXP. Welcome, y'all. This is so fun to have you back through town. You're here in February, and you get to play again. It's like double the 2022 trouble.
I know. We're so lucky. We love playing in Nashville.
Well, we loved having you here. That was such a fun sold-out show. You're at Marathon Music Works this time. But aside from touring, you played two new songs we have been loving all summer. It felt like such a summer record to me, like the your self-titled third record. But then you stripped them back just now, and it feels like fall vibes. Like, and I wanted to know about the composition of those in particular, because do you normally write on acoustic guitars and then try to like pump up the production and make it like pop-tastic for the record?
I feel like we will often approach like the acoustic arrangements after.
Yeah.
Although Katie does write on acoustic guitar, but oftentimes like when we're interpreting something for like a space like this, we've kind of tried to figure out how we can do not just like a direct transcription, but without bass and drums. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Like sometimes it just sounds weird.
Doesn't work.
It doesn't work. So we like to kind of try to make them showcase a different side of the song. Mm-hmm.
Both,
if we can.
Both Silk and Anything But Me, I started on Ableton, I believe. So those didn't start on guitar. But I like to, if a song, Anything But Me, the time signature is 12/8. And so I was like, let's change it to 6/8 when we play it on acoustic. And it kind of, I really love when you can do an acoustic version that almost sounds like a cover, because, you know, when you're approaching covers, it's like, what is the different layer emotionally that I can add to this song? And it didn't make sense necessarily to be playing acoustic and go like, me, yeah, yeah. So it was like, let's see if we, that's just a little taste.
of the acoustic record that's coming out next
taste that's of what's to come.
We're actually doing, we're doing a full, I said
acapella
record.
We're doing a full acapella record.
Yeah, we'll do a performance of that later.
Yeah.
Yeah. Next.
But time. I like how it becomes kind of a sadder breakup song when you play it acoustically.
I don't know that I needed it to be sadder, but thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Okay, so about this album, though, yeah, lots of themes of pivoting, moving on, and like, triumphant but also sad. I mean, it's meeting a lot of people where they are right now, I'm sure. Just speaking for other people, not myself.
Yeah, totally. Totally.
But how in the last year, I mean, these songs probably were written a while ago, but now that people are receiving them, how are you feeling about performing them? It's sort of a common question, but I feel like you've been touring nonstop and mm-hmm. now you're responding to people that know all the words and are like pumping their fists.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's what this is just about, you know. As soon as we put out a record, that's when I really feel like the purpose, I mean, I guess that is the purpose of all of it, to put out the record. But once the fans have the songs, like, it uncovers a new meaning, and like, you can see people have a new emotional experience to something that you spent so much time on. But it's really just about, like, we're just all trying to like sing together, like in this one room, and like have a, you know, quasi religious experience. And I don't know, it's just been really awesome, and we have the best fans in the world, and we never feel like we're just alone playing up there. It's really like a group experience, so it's just been cool. Yeah.
Did the fans have a nickname? Because I'm sitting there thinking, if it's not Muna Nights, then somebody's
that's
up.
Pretty that wow,
I've never heard that before.
That's pretty well, sick to
that's really good.
I'm not on Reddit,
they
so
call
like, I don't
themselves
know.
the they're part of the Mooniverse.
The Mooniverse.
Oh yeah. I like that too.
Yeah,
I kind of like the
Muna Nights.
My friend Rue texted me the other day.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay.
My friend Rue texted me out completely out of the blue, like, are your fans called the Moonatics? Because if not, they should be. Which is what, I think that was my mom's opinion as well.
It's kind of a mom pitch.
It's a bit of a mom pitch, and also, I guess.
We call them
pitch.
The Animaniacs.
The Animaniacs, yes.
There's so many different names. We don't really have an official name. There was like there was a fan group chat for a while that was called the Muna Celibacy Club, which I thought was really funny.
That was the last record, though. Now,
they
like
say
the,
they feel
the Muna...
betrayed by this record.
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, yeah, they were betrayed
because
by
this record. This was described, I don't remember which review, but it was like the horniest record ever. And I was like,
it's a horny record.
Yeah.
That's really funny that this is the horniest. Well, I guess for our kind of people, maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe not for other kinds
of
people.
The Moonanites, the Mooniverse, and the Celibacy Club should all like have focus group discussions
absolutely.
And decide upon the themes.
Totally.
Yeah.
No, but okay. So what did you feel like, though, this album was supposed to say? And it's your self-titled, but it's not your first. So mm-hmm. like, that's always interesting. So was this like, no, we're out here. It's really Muna.
That exactly. That was it.
Yeah.
No, we're I think that's actually really the exact
that
answer.
That was an alt title, actually. But
we out here, we're Muna.
It's really us, Muna.
Muna, .. The title is .. It's really us.
Yeah.
And then a lot of exclamation points.
I wish sometimes a title of a record could have, you know, like, I wish you could have a little play
subtitles.
Button on the album so people could hear the way
do
we
it
want
in
it
your
to
voice.
Be.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like, Muna .. It's really us. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
The delivery's important.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
That was the intention.
Maybe in the future, Joe.
Yeah.
I think
maybe that's my
I think
invention.
It was meant to feel like, you know, we thought that it was kind of an eclectic record, and it felt like a lot of bold choices for us and like for the, you know, the type of music that we make, which I guess is like, you could loosely describe it as being like alternative pop, but yeah, I think we wanted to like, you know, as we like learn and grow as a band and keep making music, I think it's the goal is always going to be like, how do we make this like interesting and fun for ourselves? And how can we like, you know, expand our skill sets? And a lot of that is just like trying to make, you know, kind of maybe not your first thought choices with stuff. And then sometimes it is about like your first thought. So
I would say in terms of the record and how we feel about it now, we're still processing and learning about the record. I think when we finished it, because we were so self-contained when we made this record, we didn't even really know what we made. We were just like, here you go, it's done. And we worked really hard and we don't know what we did. But now looking back a little bit, I can see that there's a lot of almost like contradictory elements lyrically mm-hmm. In different songs. Like, I'm in completely different headspaces. Like, sometimes feeling very hedonistic. Sometimes I'm feeling very ascetic. And I think it's about embracing that full spectrum. And just like, I know that in the beginning of writing songs for this record, I did actually have an intention coming out of the second record of wanting this third record to be more embodied. Mm-hmm. And just like more also in relationship and less like in reflection. I'm inherently like a very self-reflective person. So I think that's going to sneak in no matter what. But I know I did set out with that intention. And I think maybe because of that, it's like each song is just, it's in its own state. And there's a lot of just like trusting yourself and going with wherever you are in the present moment. And so I think that that kind of lent itself ultimately to, first of all, why we couldn't come up with like another title, because we didn't know how to like sum all the songs up other than it's just Muna. So, and then that made sense for where we were in our careers as well.
Yeah. What role did signing to Satisfactory play in all this as far as how you feel, your identity as a band, and your fan base has only grown, right? But we're an independent radio station. So I always think it's interesting to talk to folks that are independent artists on independent labels.
Yeah.
And what the difference is for music making.
I mean, I would say, to be honest, our experience at our old label, RCA, I don't think was that honestly different than our experience at Satis. In terms of our music making process, we were given a lot of creative freedom at RCA. I would say with signing to Satis, when we first were sending them songs and whatnot, we are used to a lot more critical feedback, and they were, I think, at an indie like Dead Oceans and like that whole conglomerate, they're used to being like, do you guys have a faster song? You know what I mean? And like, we're making like a lot of music. Songs, so yeah. It's, they're like, yeah, this is great. And we're like, what?
Yeah, we're still realizing that it's like, we can just turn in whatever record we want.
Yeah.
And they're going to support that. So. That's kind of
because we make fast songs.
Phoebe said she would have had more feedback if the songs had been bad, but I think she just was stoked that she thought that they were good.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think maybe we're kind of hard on ourselves too, and like I don't know. I mean, it's interesting to think about because I think there are songs on this record that were picked as singles that would not have even made the record. Anything But Me.
Yeah, Anything But Me is a super controversial song based on like the people that we share music with. But I think if anything, it's like there's some decisions on our last record that like I certainly don't agree with that were like, you know, singles and things like that.
Yeah,
that
totally.
Like we made more of those decisions for ourselves and like kind of push for it on this record. And Phoebe was also one of the people like pushing for Anything But Me to be a single. And like that decision was ultimately like awesome.
That's, and people one of our, love that song.
Yeah, exactly.
So like, you know,
we know the sauce, and I think it's like maybe that is also part of the Muna of this record, is like being completely in charge of like those decisions and feeling confident in them. And I don't know if we exactly were there with our other two.
Yeah, what people heard and in what order they could and like consume this, and
totally
then the whole thing came and it was like yes.
Yeah. And it's also really great to work with. I mean, we love working with Phoebe, and she understands who we are as people and who we are as a band. And so I think that has helped us a ton.
Yeah.
Like, to just have somebody who understands you, who is part of helping you like market your shit as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, speaking of people and feeling trusting and supporting, like you all seem to have this great affiliation still after all this time on the road. You seem like to be having a great time. So you don't get sick of each other on the bus?
We like take space for ourselves, but to be honest with you, like we still share hotel rooms. Like
yeah, the three of us
so we're like rotating sharing a bed. We're very close.
It's
like,
better when we're closer, I would say. Cause it's like then you can't really be avoidant.
We have to do a lot of check-ins.
Yeah.
Family meetings.
Yeah, we have family meeting. We have family weeping, I guess, every day, it seems.
Okay.
We also do just like love all the people that we tour with, like, you know, everyone who plays in the band with us and like who works with us behind the scenes. Like, we hang out on the bus. And like last night, a bunch of us were in the lobby playing poker with M&Ms, like as chips.
Iconic.
You know what I mean?
I like, thought you said playing poker with M&M, and I was like, which hotel?
That would be crazy. Yeah. No, but we were betting. We were betting with M&Ms, and we were getting cleaned out by our drummer. But
yeah, our drummer actually hustled us all. So
he's a hustler.
That's all I gotta
say. In the camera. I hope
if also
this.
If you knew him, he is like the most soft-spoken person, and then he became a demon.
He wiped us clean.
Monster when competitive.
Yeah.
But yeah, it is. I mean, we always say like we're very lucky to be in a band. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I don't know how we had the foresight. It's like it wouldn't be worth it to do this if you didn't get to do it with other people. And also, I think it's a chance to, like, this is our company, mm-hmm. so it's like we have a chance to conduct this in a way that, like, you know, we feel good about in like the hellscape that is capitalism, and like just do what we can to make sure that the people that we work with like feel connected and feel connected to a purpose, and you know, can like be honest about what's going on in their lives. And you know, that means a lot. That means just as much to me as like playing good shows. So we're lucky. I love everyone.
I feel like we're lucky because these songs appear in the hellscape that is all of this.
Sure.
So thanks for writing them. Thanks for playing them. I also have to address that your shirt, it was covered, their guitar show, your Cranberry shirt.
It's an iconic one.
Yeah. That's very rare.
The best. And I love that.
It's a great shirt. I've had it for many years and it's starting to get little holes. So I'm like, I brought a little sewing kit.
You got a love on it on the tour? Like,
it needs, some love. I'm trying to keep this for a long time.
Well, thanks. Long live Dolores. Long live Muna.
R.I.P.
And the Muna Nights. Starting now.
Yeah.
Yes.
Awesome.
Thanks for being here. Mic
drop. Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Wow. Gonna talk to you for much longer.
Thank you.